Hello, I'm Graham Horton and welcome to today's product review for the Weeylite Ninja 200 Professional LED Light. Now, if you've never heard of Weeylite before, and that was the case with me until a month ago when they contacted me with the view to me showcasing their products. You may have heard of the brand name Viltrox and Weeylite are synonymous with one another. Viltrox produce a fantastic range of camera accessories and even lenses for cameras these days, so you're well aware of the quality of the products they produce. And the Ninja 200 is no exception to that rule. Now, first of all, a full disclaimer, I was provided this light by Weeylite to review for you, but as usual with all my reviews, that doesn't colour my opinion as to the quality of the build, the adherence to their published specifications and claims, and then I'll do a full product test to verify all those claims and specifications. I'll then show you some accessories that you can purchase for this light, which puts it into a category way above any other studio or field light of this particular type. So let's get started, let's unbox this and show you what you get with the basic kit, and then I'll show you the accessories later on. So this is the nice padded bag that you get to carry your light around. Not only is it padded, but the sides are actually hard shell as well, so you're going to get lots of protection when you're moving this light around. Opening up the bag, which has got two nice functional zips so you can actually open the case fully. In the lid is a strap which allows you to fit this to the side straps and carry it over your shoulder if you wanted to do that. More importantly are the contents of the bag, and we've got the warranty and registration card. We've got a basic user manual here which describes the lighting setup and how to use the remote controller, and more importantly, the app, which you can run on a smartphone to control this light as well. You see inside the bag, plenty of room for accessories. It's got compartmentalized dividers here, which you've got Velcro, so you can move them around to fit the accessories you're going to put in here. We've got the light itself, and I'll bring that out in a moment. We'll mount that on the light stand and set it up. We've got the mini Barons reflector, which gives you a spotlight effect. That's provided with the kit. And the mains wall power brick assembly, so you've got 14 feet or 3.5 meters of cable, so plenty of cable there, so you can set this up in the studio and not be bothered with your short that runs or having to use extension cable. So a good length of cable on that light. So let me set it up on a stand and we'll compare the quoted specifications to the actual specifications we can get. So this is the Weeylite Ninja 200. Mounted it on a light stand so we can actually control it. Measures 175mm, that's from front to back, 92mm wide and 85mm high. So it's quite a compact unit. Two mounting holes here, which we'll talk about later, they're for applying a battery plate to power this from Sony MPF 970 batteries. Rotate it round to the business end, you can see the COB light. Now normally that will be protected by a small plastic shield to protect the COB, but to run the light you must remove that because the heat generated by that will probably melt the plastic. So the COB light consists of alternate rows of the 8500 Kelvin, the blue light, and the 2800 Kelvin amber light. A mixture of each will give you the desired colour temperature you want. So if you want, say, 5600 degree, there'll be the amber light on and there'll be the cold light on. So a mixture of both. Around the cob light is the mini bayonet, which allows you to attach the accessories for the light itself. Let's have a look now at some of the controls on the back panel. We've got our power input socket here, which is the 18 volts needed to drive this lamp. Type-C input here, which allows us to upgrade the firmware should there be one available on the Weeylite website. Mode switch, which allows us to change the group and the channel number, also allows us to change some of the features in the background of the operation of the lamp, and I'll come back to those in a moment. We've also got the power on off switch here and a multifunction button here, which is controlling both the color temperature and the brightness of the lamp. Let me just go back to that background mode. So if you press and hold the mode switch, it takes you into a background menu here, which allows you to cycle through some of the operations. At the moment we're in the fan mode and it allows you to turn the fan off. If you're using this lamp at low power, then you can actually run it with the fan off and it will not overheat. If you're using it at high temperatures, then it will actually switch itself back on again if you've got that enabled. So at the moment the fan is off, if I just press the button here, it will turn on the fan. You might just be able to hear that fan running up now. I press it, it'll turn it off. And if we actually measure the sound level of that, so the ambient room noise, if I stop talking, about 30 decibels. If I turn on the fan, get an increase of about 20 decibels. That's a distance of what, 10 centimeters to the fan enclosure. At a normal working distance, and if I bring that to where I'm standing now, which is about 2 feet away from the device, it's at 15 dB. So if you're close to the fan, you might hear it, but with a normal lavalier mic at your normal working distance of say a meter, or with a shotgun mic at a meter and a half, you're probably not gonna hear this fan noise. It's slightly louder than my Godox SL60W, but I've never had any issues with that. And during the filming with some other videos with this light, again, I've not been able to hear that background fan noise. But you can turn it off if you find it obtrusive by putting it into the fan mode and then turning it off. If you press the button one more time, it will take you into the update mode, so it allows you to use the Type-C input and connect it to your PC or laptop to upgrade the firmware. One more time gives you the opportunity to set the Bluetooth channel. Press it one more time and you can go into the temperature over limit warning. If you've got the temperature mode set to on, then even if you've got the fan off, you'll find that the lamp will start to reduce brightness to protect the cob elements if it's starting to overheat. Around this side of the lamp, we've got the clamp. This is a rather interesting feature. We've got the serrated teeth of the lamp and the clamp, but in between those is a rubber washer. So there's sufficient tension on there for the light reflector, or if you're not using it with a reflector. If you're using this with a larger Bowens adapter with the adapter plate you can purchase, then you may need to remove that rubber washer to allow the two teeth to engage to give you a firm grip on the lamp. But I found it's been fine if you just tighten this up securely. On the lower part of the mount, we've got the clamp, which allows you to clamp it to your light stand. You can either mount it in the vertical mode here if you want the lamp horizontal, or switch around to the vertical mode if you want to move the lamp to its vertical position. So I've got multiple mounting operations. On the top of the unit is a vent which allows the lamp to be force cooled by the internal fan. Let's power it up and let's check some of the specifications of the lamp. So my first test is actually to validate that this is actually a 60 watt output. Got the light set to 5600, so that's midway between the 28 and 8500. Running at 100%, and I've got my porta power in series with the mains power supply, so we're monitoring the input to this unit. You can see here we've got 17.6 volts at 3.57 amps. Given us a total combination of 63 watts. So we are running at 60 watts, which is the claimed output power for the light. If we adjust the light output, then obviously it will change the power. So at the moment we're at 100%, and if I use the remote controller and set this up to 50%, so the light's now at 50%, the power is 35 watts. If I go down to 30%, the power is 31 watts. So that's the sort of power levels you'll be achieving with the lamp at its various brightness. Want to now check the claimed light output. First of all, without the reflector that's supplied with the kit, and then with the reflector at the 1 meter distance. So let me set that up and we'll measure the light output. Obviously, I have to turn off all the other studio lights, but there should be enough light for us to film this sequence. So I've now got the light set up on a light stand, and the front face of the cob to the front face of my meter there is exactly 1 meter. You can see we're measuring a luminance value of 2000 lux. So that's at 100% and 5600 Kelvin. I'm now going to change the color temperature so that we'll go down to the 2800 and we'll see if there's any change to the light output. So I'm just going to press the switch in to change the color temperature, and I'm going to drop it down to 2800. And you can see the temperature is now 2800 and the lux output is 1500, or between 1500 and 1600. So a little bit of light loss when you go to the lower color temperature. Now let's go to the higher color temperature of 8500. And at 8500, it's 2200 lux. So it's brighter at the cooler color temperatures of 8500 and slightly dimmer at the warmer temperatures of 2800. But at the 5600, which is daylight, without the reflector, we're measuring 2000 lux. I'm now going to fit the standard reflector which comes with this kit, and we can see the change in light output. So with the meter again set up at 1 meter away from the light, and with the power output at 100% and a color temperature of 5600 Kelvin, you can see we're measuring a display of between 14,000 and 16,000 lumens. So probably the average is about 15,000. Going to reduce the power output to 50%, and let's have a look at the linearity of the meter. So let's go down to 50%, and that's showing 8,300. So that's fairly linear. Let's go down to 40%. So 8,000, go down to 30%, 7,000, go down to 20%, 6,800. So it's becoming less linear as we go down the lower end of the scale. So if I go down to 10%, there's hardly been any change. And if I go down to the 1%, there's hardly any change. So it's not really linear at the bottom end, but at the working range that you're going to be using this, say at between 50 and 100%, then it is fairly linear. So this is the standard reflector mounted on the Ninja 200, but with the additional purchase of the VPO5 adapter, you can actually use standard Boeing fittings. So you can use larger reflectors, beauty dishes and soft boxes with this light to give you more controlled light output. Let me fit that. So we just need to depress the button in the middle of the adapter. We fit this by just fitting that the way you would the adapter into the lens ring, and it clips in place. Once you've done that, you can mount standard dishes and control your light. This one's got a hole in that. You could use silver umbrellas to reflect the light back, or nylon diffuse umbrellas to give you a softer light. Well, the next accessory I want to show you is the WB2 battery plate, and this transforms your studio light into a very portable light source. You can use it outdoors where you've not got access to any mains at all. So it's great for outdoor location lighting, and is an additional purchase you can make, the WB2 battery plate. And it fits onto those 2 1/4-20 screw holes on the side of the lamp. So let's just attach that, pull the lips down, and this will now take to standard Sony NPF type batteries. Obviously use the larger ones, the 970 type. Once you've got the plate mounted, you notice here there's a slide switch marked in and out. The in is to allow you to use USB-C power delivery to charge your two Sony batteries that are on here. When you switch it to the out position, it outputs the output from your two Sony batteries to give you the 16 volts for the light. And you connect this plate with a connecting cable which goes into the socket here, and this would replace the mains input on your light source, so that will plug into your light as normal. Then you can fit your two Sony NPF batteries into the plate. You need the two to give you the 16 volts, it won't work with one. And you notice now we've got a display which is showing the battery status. These are fully charged and the status is 100%. So I can actually now turn on the light and it's being powered now from those Sony NPF 970 batteries. Obviously at 100% you're drawing 3.8 amps, so you're going to get about an hour's worth of power from these two batteries to give you outdoor locations. But you can use your remote control to turn off the light in between shoots. So again, with the RC11 remote controller, you can control the power output and the color temperature and any of the scene modes, of which there are 12, which are things like lightning flashes, campfires. They're easier to set up actually using the app on your smartphone, which I'll be demonstrating in a moment. But the remote control does give you that access to turn the lamp on and off and change its power level without having to go back to your light to change those settings if you're on location. So the RC11 is a good addition if you want to just change power. Now, a lot of the features on this remote controller aren't relevant to the Ninja 200. This is a control that you use across all the range of Weeylite lamps. It controls RGBW lamps, for instance, where this is just bicolor, so those functions won't be available with this controller. But nevertheless, gives you access to power and color temperature and access to the scene modes. Let me show you the app that you can load to your smartphone, which gives you a lot more control of the lamp and easier to set those scene modes. So the app, once you've loaded it on your smartphone and connected it to the lamp, will give you control of brightness and color temperature and access to some of the common color temperatures such as shade, bright sunlight, overcast, those sort of things. Immediate access to those. So if I wanted to go to a color temperature of 3000 for tungsten, I just touch that and again the lamp has now changed to tungsten. If I wanted to go to sunlight, then I can just change it back to sunlight. Now the cool feature about the app is the way in which you can control the scene modes. Now these will contain some flashing images, so if you are photosensitive, then please do look away from your screen. By switching into scene mode, you can actually then bring up the array of the modes that are available, which there are 12 for this particular lamp. Having selected a scene mode, you can change it between slow, normal and fast, so you can change the rate at which it flickers. You can also change the intensity as well of the light itself. So easy access to any of these scene modes that are available for this particular lamp. Simple touch of CCT, which is color temperature, you can bring it back and you can change the color temperature with the slider and you can change the brightness with the slider. You can control multiple lamps. You've got the six groups and 20 channels if you wanted to control more than one lamp with this particular lighting app. Now we've already measured the light output and found that it was very close to the published specification. I haven't got any meters which will give me a reading of CRI, but I've got a test chart which we can shoot under 5600 Kelvin with the Ninja 200 and then take the same test chart at noonday sunlight and compare the two charts to see if there's any difference, particularly in the skin tones and blues of this chart, which will give you an indication as to how good this relates to daylight. I've got an app that runs on my smartphone which gives you a sort of spectral response for lighting, and I've done a test of this lamp comparing it to the Godox SL60W, which is the standard studio light that I use. And the Godox is about 18 months old and it's showing a tendency to give a little bit of a magenta tint, so I need to filter that out with a bit of green colour gel to bring it back to a neutral point. But this one is showing a fairly neutral colour response compared to that Godox 60W. So you can see on screen now the two graphs of the two lights for comparison. We've now seen how this light performs against the specifications. fairly good in terms of its output power at 16,000 lux, and in terms of its CRI, using those color test charts, we can see it's very close to the daylight condition. So the CRI of 95 plus looks to be good and well confirmed. The standard dish did give you a hotspot, but again, using diffusers, you could spread that out. And again, with that Bowens adapter, you can attach many of the Bowens fittings to this light to give you much more controlled lighting using softboxes, etc. We've seen how it can be adapted to give you the DC input from Sony MPF 970 batteries, which means this light can be used outside on location without access to main. So that is one of the key features, I think, of this light. If you get that WB2 battery plate, it gives you a lot more flexibility and use this outdoors. I'll be using it for some of my nature shots when we don't get sunlight. I can use this to add additional lighting with diffusion to capture my fungus and plants, which I love to photograph. So, in summary, is this light value for money? Well, at £200 here in the UK, I think it definitely is. Of course, you've got to buy the additional accessories, such as the Bowens mount adapter, if you want to adapt it for Bowens. The battery plate, again, you would have to purchase on your Sony MPF batteries. But again, those are probably worthwhile considerations if you want to get the very best out of this light. The RC11 controller, again, is worthwhile if you want to use this to switch the light on and off and change power levels without having to go to the back of the light. Or you can do that from the smartphone app and control all the other features very easily with that smartphone app. So that's the Ninja 200 from Weeylite. In my opinion, a very good light and one which I'll be using quite extensively in the studio. And in fact, the previous video I shot was using this light set up in my studio. You can see an episode from it now. You can see the light is very good and even to provide me with that main light for my studio setup. So that's it for the video. Thanks very much for watching. If you do like what you see, why not hit that subscribe button and the bell notification icon, and you'll be advised when I upload new videos in this series. So thanks very much for watching. Please do take care, and I'll see you all in my next one. Goodbye for now.